Support Black Bear Mirage, The Bachelor. I'm back. Just was kind of thinking about some stuff, and I want to drop some wisdom real quick. This for men and women, but I want women to really listen in particular. You know, all the men, I want you all to listen, because a lot of these lessons hadn't been taught, because alpha masculinity has been stripped in, you know, society, and basically any type of expression of alpha masculinity, you will be attacked. So a lot of men don't even like being men. Anyway, this is what I want to drop. I want to drop a spiritual concept that the alpha masculine leader must have. And it is called emotional stoicism or emotional endurance. You've heard me talk about this before. And I want to just go into this real quick. This is a trait that I've always had my whole life. I never really understood it early on because I thought I was just cold hearted. And I thought that I just wasn't sensitive to certain things. But this is just a trait that I guess I naturally genetically came with, and I didn't really have to adopt it, learn it. But most men usually learn it because they have certain emotional trauma, and then they adjust themselves because of it. But there is a character that is the best symbol of emotional stoicism, or at least right now it's the best symbol for us to use in this tape, and that is Darth Vader. Darth Vader is basically the, of course, the dark Sith Lord that we know of in Star Wars. But let's go into the background real quick. First of all, Darth Vader was a regular man who had regular emotions, okay? Regular emotions meaning that, you know, he probably would react to what happens to him. So that means when something good happens, he reacts like he's happy. Something bad happens, he reacts like he's mad. But long story short, in the early Star Wars, Darth Vader, or Anakin Skywalker rather, when he was younger, he had a girlfriend. I think her name was Padme or something like that. But anyway, there was a situation happened where he thought she died. And then Anakin Skywalker went through a very, very dangerous situation himself with his battle with Obi-Wan Kenobi. And this is when it led to him, of course, getting the suit. Now, when he ended up getting the suit, his consciousness was completely different. He had just got done experiencing a lot of trauma, and his emotional state was a lot different. So you now have the character known as Darth Vader. Now, Darth Vader is very, very emotionally stoic. He doesn't really have any reactions to much. He doesn't react like the average person does. And this can be seen by his facial expression. Now, although he has on a mask, but it's very, very esoteric and occult how he keeps the same facial expression in all types of situations. So this is a man who is emotionally stoic. And I told you all before that in order for an alpha leader to be successful in life, he has to have emotional endurance in the face of adversity. So sometimes when men face, you know, things that could, you know, raise fear, it can start adrenaline pumping. You know, it can make your hands start sweating. You know, man can get nervous. And this is very, very natural because this is just what the human body physically will go through and physiologically will go through. Any kind of, you know, experience, you know, you have your fight or flight senses, you know, your survival senses kick in. This is what happens. So a lot of the times when you think that you may be afraid of something, you're not necessarily emotionally or psychologically afraid. It's just your hormones and different adrenaline and all that stuff is pumping. So you're taking that as you're afraid. And usually we respond and behave because of misunderstanding those hormones inside of us. But anyway, when a man has this going on, you know, he has to be able to hold his ground. If not, usually he will, you know, be conquered, and man won't be able to survive, because the tundra that Malkuth, you know, provides is a very, very rough one. And there are a lot of things that can create fear on Earth. So if a man doesn't have that ability to be emotionally stoic and have emotional endurance, he will damage himself. So that's what you see in Darth Vader, a character who is emotionally stoic. And, you know, throughout the whole movie, of course, you know, his son, Heru or Luke Skywalker, was actually the one to kind of, you know, reawaken his consciousness. You know what I'm saying? So kind of show him that, you know, he can be he can open up to his son, because that's what happened with him and Luke Skywalker. But anyway, I just brought up Darth Vader because he is the symbol of emotional stoicism. And this archetypal energy must be adopted by so-called black men who think they want to be successful. Because another area that you have to be emotionally stoic in is with the realm of woman. Now, this is very, very important because when you're dealing with women, this is one of the only places that man has to be a little vulnerable. You know, when we doing things in life such as, you know, trying to get resources, working, etc. A lot of the times we can have our defense and our guards up. You know, we don't always have to. In other words, we have to always be on point. You know what I'm saying? Like, you have to always be sharp. But usually when you're dealing with your woman, that's when a guy kind of is going to relax a little bit. And he comes to a state of vulnerability sometimes. And most women know this. You know what I'm saying? Although they may not say it, but most women know that men naturally are going to become vulnerable to them. As I've told you all before in the past, if the COINTELPRO or any kind of intelligence agency wanted to spy on somebody, they know that the easiest spies could be women, and women can get a lot closer. Let's think about it. You have a so-called drug lord who's selling drugs, and the police want to investigate him. They got two type of people that can get in there to investigate and have a wire. One of them could be a man acting like they're his friend, and then another one could be a woman who's, you know, alleged that supposedly his girlfriend. The man is only going to be able to get so far. You know what I'm saying? Because at the end of the day, when it's time to go to bed, you know, that other man has his own home. You know what I'm saying? So he can't get too deep into the core or the nucleus of whoever the target is, which is the drug lord. But a woman can be around a man 24/7 and it don't seem weird. You know, like usually guys want to have their alone time or be with a woman at some point. Even if you got homeboys and stuff, it's like you don't want to be around them all the time. But your chick, you know, you may not mind if she's around, you know what I'm saying, versus, let's say, a male all the time. So, you know, if I know that, you know what I'm saying, then anybody that's dealing with intelligence, they know that, too. So the easiest spy could be a woman because she can get to that emotional, vulnerable state that a man has, you know. So I want to give you an example of emotional stoicism, because one thing that I noticed with women is they don't understand a lot of the codes of man. And one of the codes of man is that your face card and your integrity is all. Your face card and your integrity is all. And once it is contaminated, then the man no longer wants to deal with you, because usually a woman is going to be a symbol of the man's so-called success. Or the man's, let's say, his aura, you know, where he's vibrating from usually. So she's like a flag, you know what I'm saying? That's why most men, if you'll know if a man fuck with you or not, because he'll go into public with you. You know, even if he don't date you or something like that, it's just still he don't mind being seen with you, because a woman is representing somewhat of like a flag. So you know how when you see, you know, a team and the team had a flag waving, and that flag kind of just represents, you know, that faction. That's kind of what a woman is for a man. She's like a flag. She's like, you know, she's like a symbol. You know what I'm saying? Like how you have a coat of arms or something like that. That's kind of what the woman represents. So a man doesn't want a contaminated symbol. He doesn't want anything that's, you know, going to, you know, resonate with him, that's going to muddy and murk up his face card. And I want to give you an example of this, because this is a situation where a man had to be emotionally stoic, because he was in a situation where a woman didn't understand a particular man code, and he had to save his emotional state. Because what happens is women don't understand when men turn off and why men turn off. You know, they'll say like, oh, well, you just went from hot to cold. You was, you know, saying baby this and baby that, bringing me flowers and doing this and doing that, and all of a sudden you stopped, you know, and they just be wondering like, why do we go from hot to cold like that? A lot of times a man will go from hot to cold like that and go into a state of being emotionally stoic, because that is how men defend the heart chakra. Let me repeat, using emotional endurance and emotional stoicism and sometimes cutting off from the woman is how men emotionally defend themselves. So that's just like a natural tactic that we have. A lot of times, instead of arguing with somebody or getting into some type of confrontation, a man will just detach himself and just stop caring about the situation, you know, totally. And that's usually what we do, because we don't like exerting resources and any kind of physical energy that really isn't necessary. So that's typically what we'll do. We'll just totally detach from it. So that means we'll stop talking to that woman, give her the cold shoulder or whatever it is we do. Here's the example. And I want the women to listen very, very close to this, because we're going to analyze this code as I end the story. So recently we had a woman who was the so-called person that accused Tupac of rape. And we know in the early 90s that the brother Tupac Shakur was alleged to so-called have sexually assaulted a woman. They came and arrested this brother, and he was literally in jail for this. Okay. So we all know about this story. And even if we don't know about it, you know all the details, we've heard about it. Okay. So what we have recently, we have this woman comes out and she tells a story, you know what I'm saying? Allegedly that Tupac, you know, met her. And next thing you know, I'm kind of fast forwarding a lot. She says that she met him at the club. Everything was going okay. You know, they hooked up a few times, you know what I'm saying? Kicked it a few times. Then maybe on like the fourth or fifth time they saw each other, she said, her and Tupac were, long story short, in a room, and Tupac kind of restrained her while some other guys, you know, sexually assaulted her. And this is what the woman is saying, okay? This is what her story is. Now, you look at this woman, she don't really even look like she's telling the truth. It sounds very, very foolish. And that, when I heard the story, it was just like, wow, like, you mean this brother was in jail for something like this? Like, this don't even, she don't even look like she's telling the truth. So, you know, I just immediately had some just compassion for that brother because he apparently went through a lot, you know, from dealing with this shit. But then, you know, you're going to have people that are close to the situation that personally know Tupac and personally know this woman. And it's because it's the social media age. People are going to come out and give their own take on what really happened. And I came across a tape where a brother was saying he gave what the real story was. And he said that he personally knew Tupac. And he said that he had even asked Tupac, you know, what really went down. Because, of course, you're going to ask, you know, the man, like, what really happened, like, when you see him. And he said Tupac told him exactly what happened. And after the man told the story, it was amazing because I started thinking about certain situations I know of personally. And it was right on the money. So let me tell you what the brother said. So the brother was saying that he asked Tupac, well, what really happened? And he said that Tupac was saying that, you know, that he liked the woman and stuff like that, that they were dating and, you know, and Tupac was sending the limousine for her and stuff like that, etc. And then he made a good point. He said, now, you got to remember that this is Tupac Shakur, a man that can get any woman. So if he's sending limousines to pick somebody up and stuff like that, you know, he probably does have some type of interest because he doesn't have to do that. And I think he even used an example of, you know, Tupac could just go in the lobby of a hotel and just get a woman to sleep with him if it was about that. And I started thinking like, yeah, that is true, because Tupac could easily get a woman. So he didn't have to wine and dine no woman and get no limousine to do all these different things. So first code is for women to know that when men start whining, so-called whining and dining you, whether it's using money or giving you attention, even if he ain't using no money, that is a sign that that man really like you. But anyway, so he said that Tupac was doing this and everything was cool. He was feeling the woman and stuff, you know, was in the public being seen with her X, Y, and Z and all this, right? So then he said that Pac said that one day they was at the hotel. Everything was cool. He ended up falling asleep. And he said when he woke up, his homeboys came to him and was like, you know, X, Y, and Z, you know, we smashed old girl or whatever. And he said that, you know, when they said he told Pop, he said Pop didn't really respond like he was mad. You know, he was just more like, oh, okay, like, wow, like, damn, she getting down like that, you know. So the homies basically was just like letting him know, like, yeah, she ain't, you know, she ain't really what she's saying she is. Like, you know, don't even take that too serious. So Pop was like, you know, cool. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, apparently Tupac probably was still talking to the woman, but, you know, he ain't gonna take her that serious no more. So ain't going to be no more going to the restaurant. Ain't going to be no more holding your hand. Ain't going to be no more letting no limousine pull up on you. Ain't going to be no more being seen with you in public. Like, ain't going to be none of that shit. You going to goddamn, you know, get a few little dollars for the cab. You know what I'm saying? Come over, get smashed out, and then that's it. You know, ain't going to be none of that other shit. So apparently, you know, so this is probably how the brother Tupac started treating her. And then after a while, she kind of putting two and two together and seeing like, damn, this nigga ain't really treat me the same no more. And she would have had to known why, because you just smashed the homies. Like, so you got to think, like, Tupac already is looking a certain way because he been seen with this woman, winding and dining this woman. But now on the back end, you really just come out to be this smut that the homies really just tried overnight and smashed you. And then I think the excuse that she used was that she thought it was pleasing Tupac. So she thinking she pleasing Tupac by having sex with his friends. So anyway, you know, so all this is going down and with the ego of woman, and then with woman always, you know, running to try to clean up her image, of course, she ran and, you know, tried to say that this man so-called raped her. Now, but I want to focus more on the emotional stoicism that Tupac had to display, though. You see, Tupac was not going to let himself look like a fool in front of his friends, okay? So Tupac did what any logical man would do that has emotional endurance. He's going to detach from the situation. So sometimes you've heard black bears say that I'm emotionally detached from so-called black women. This is what I mean by that. When you are in a situation and things get muddy and things get cloudy, like I just said a little while ago, a man will emotionally detach to defend himself. So that's how that goes, because at the end of the day, because a lot of these, you know, black males and black females out here who have destructive behavior, see, because they have the same skin tones as we do, you know, just by that alone, you're going to be associated with them, whether you like them or not, whether you want to be around them or not, whether you acknowledge them or not, etc. It doesn't matter. Like, you know, we're going to always have to answer for that. As I've said in previous takes before, especially with black men, like, we're not even given the right as individual. You know, one black man could have dreads and commit a robbery. Now, all of a sudden, every black man with dreads and that don't have dreads is being pulled over and is a suspect. So we don't have the right of individuality. So, you know, I'm saying all that to say, fuck that shit. I want to go back to the emotional stoicism of Tupac, because that's kind of what the point is with that shit, because it ties in even with Darth Vader. So Tupac Shakur, not going to make himself look like a fool. The first thing he's going to do is emotionally detach from himself. Okay, so at first he was thinking like, dang, you know, maybe I thought the woman was cool. Just like, let's say, the average black man. You know, dang, I thought black women may have been cool. But then, you know, let's say he sees some, I don't know, cumdump.com or ghetto gagger shit, a Negro newsnicker shit. Just like how Tupac all of a sudden, excuse me, now figures out that this woman ain't as cool because she just smashed a homie. So what Tupac is going to do, and then what the black man is going to do, is he's going to emotionally detach. He's no longer going to be vested in the situation, you see. And this is a strategy that man does. And Darth Vader did it in the movie when he thought Padme died, and that emotionally just ruined him. And in order to save himself from feeling that pain, what he did was is he totally detached, not only psychologically from Padme, but really from the concept of, let's say, love, period. And this kind of led you to what you saw in Darth Vader. And this is why he had to have his son, Luke Skywalker, come redeem him, because sometimes when the alpha male detaches like that, he can drift deeper and deeper into the darkness, because that's essentially what happens. You know what I'm saying? And he has to have his own consciousness redeem him so he doesn't, you know, become too cold. Because when you become emotionally stoic, if you're not careful and you polarize it, then you'll start becoming cold against yourself. You know, you'll seem bitter. You'll seem like you're mad at, you know, let's say so-called women or whatever. Like in this example, so-called black women. And that's what happened. So just like with Tupac. So that's what Tupac did. You know what I'm saying? His own Christ consciousness, you know, not only was he emotionally stoic, but his Christ consciousness saved him, because he didn't just get mad at all women. So Tupac just said, what the hell with this woman? You know, that's how she was. So he just moved on and probably got with the next woman, just like a Blackbeard. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, just because I may see, let's say, a Negro bed snitch tape, you know, I'm not going to think it's all black women. I'm going to just emotionally detach and just keep it moving, you know. So that's what it is. But this is a very, very, very much needed tactic for alpha men. You know, you're not going to be able to really lead, and you're not going to be able to be that successful if you don't have no type of emotional endurance, you just won't. That's why the blackup male exists, because black women are counting on you beta men and your lack of emotional stoicism, you know. And also, too, women don't even respect men that don't have emotional stoicism, you see, because that's not a trait that women have. Like, usually when a woman gets emotional about something, what does she typically do? She starts investing in it, right? She starts, you know, getting deeper into it. You know what I'm saying? So she typically becomes, you know, her emotion actually becomes cumulative and it piles upon each other. Whereas with a man, you know, usually he detaches. He does the complete opposite. So he severs his emotion totally, you know, whenever it starts happening with him. So when men, you know, face a situation, they divest emotionally. When a woman faces a situation, they invest emotionally. You see? And this is also one of the reasons why a lot of these men in the West have problem with these women. Because a lot of men are reacting like women. They don't have no emotional stoicism. So subconsciously, women expect men to have this because they know they don't. And they know that this is very, very key for genetic survival. And it's very, very key also for security, too, on Mount Coop. So if you don't have emotional stoicism, it's going to be a lot of women that's probably going to stay away from you, you know, because you're going to seem like you can't really defeat any kind of challenge. You know, you're going to seem like you quickly going to mold and fold, you know, quickly going to get knocked off of your square, you know. But I just was thinking about that, this emotional stoicism. You know, this is something that I have mastered. And, you know, a part of it is becoming cold. I will say that. So I don't want to make it seem like it's something that's cool. It's much needed, but I wouldn't say it's necessarily cool. It would be almost like, you know, taking some type of medicine to prevent yourself from getting sick. You know, but the medicine may not taste that good, but it's going to do something good for you. So that's what emotional stoicism is. It's like, you know, yeah, it may be a little cold. You know, yeah, people may think you bitter. You know what I'm saying? But you're really not. But at the end of the day, in the long run, it's going to help protect you. And you won't find yourself getting mad when you have little hiccups in life. You know what I'm saying? When you have little, you know, run-ins with women. And it may be a good run and then it just ends, you know what I'm saying? You'll be able to kind of move on. Like you won't be, you know, shocked by her beauty and just feeling like, you know what I'm saying? You can't get another one as good as her. You see, you'll be able to just move on, you know? So this is a very, very much needed trait. And, excuse me. And, it's just needed, you know? And also, I tell you this, too. Women tend to chase the men who are emotionally stoic. Let me repeat. Women tend to chase the men who are emotionally stoic. The men that act like they really don't care about them like that. The men that really don't get too hyped up about, you know, we can say energetic situations or dramatic situations. Basically, the men who seem always kind of mellow, you know, really nonchalant, don't really care like that. See, these are the type of guys that they chasing because they want to feel like, you know, they can make him care. They want to feel like they can make him emotional. They want to feel like they can change him. Oh, man, when I give him this pussy, man, I know he going to change. He going to do this and he going to do that. You know what I'm saying? When I give him this head, I know he going to change. So what they do is they start now, you know, going into overload and overdrive, trying to break you out of your emotional stoicism, you see. But what they're going to end up doing is kind of showering you with affection and gifts. Ultimately, that's kind of what they end up doing. Or at least that's what I've experienced. Like a lot of these women that come across me, they'll kind of think that I'm mysterious and stuff like that because they can tell that I'm very, very communicative, but I don't let them get that close. And they be wondering why, because I'm very, very social. But it's like, you know, it's just a certain part of my personality that I have kind of like a slick wall up. So, you know, and that's my emotional stoicism. So, and when they see that, it makes them kind of want to crack the mystery and try to figure out, well, why is he this way? And, you know, and what hurt him and what happened to him? And they try to like come with this like mother nurturing affection type of goddamn energy. You know what I'm saying? But it, like I said, but it ends up just turning into a lot of food, attention, sex, and basically whatever else it is that I want her to give me. But that's what they end up doing. So there are, you know, there are pros to being emotionally stoic, because women will find you as a mystery and they will want to try to solve the mystery. They're going to mainly want to try to figure out, why are you the way you are? Like, for example, I guarantee a lot of the women that listen to Tommy Sotomayor, they want to try to figure out why he's the way he is. They want to try to figure out, what was that key situation that happened to him that made him, you know, mad and stuff like that? Because they may think he's mad, but he's not mad. He's acting from a place of emotional stoicism. You see, because he doesn't care. He's emotionally detached. That's why he can talk about him the way he does. And I've heard Tommy Sotomayor before. He doesn't sound like he hates black women. I mean, a lot of shit I've heard him say, he actually has kept it 100. But he's just emotionally stoic. And that's what you have with this called, this red pill, what they call the red pill philosophy. That's a term that I'm hearing some of the brothers use, the red pill philosophy. That's what that is. That's the emotional stoicism, you see. So this is not giving no kind of vulnerability to a woman. You know, you can't do it, because at the end of the day, they're going to take advantage of that shit. They're going to do it. Because you got to remember, when you're dealing with a woman, you're already going to be naturally somewhat vulnerable anyway. But if you start becoming psychologically and emotionally vulnerable, you fucked up. That's almost like giving a baby the wheel to a goddamn, you know, semi-trailer, big-ass tractor-trailer truck, you know. And you're going to expect that baby to, like, be able to control that big truck. You ain't going to be able to do that, you know. So that's what you men are saying when y'all become emotionally vulnerable to these women. What you saying is that, you know, she's not going to wreck your shit. But at the end of the day, you know, I don't know. Because I find it very funny that, you know, a lot of these women, they be crying to make it seem like these men are emotionally making them traumatized. But I actually think it's the opposite when I look at a lot of this stuff. These women are traumatizing these men. That's really what it is. You know what I'm saying? That's what it is. Because that's not really expected. You know what I'm saying? Women already know that most men just want to have sex. You know, so if you get duped by that, maybe that's more some lack of discernment on your end. Okay? But men, because of the way society trains men, men think women are perfect. Men think women don't make no mistakes. Men think that women don't think about cheating. Men think, you know what I'm saying, women are just these angels. So they're not coming in the door expecting a lot of this bullshit that they end up getting in return. That's why they be marrying y'all. That's why they give y'all rings. That's why they get in these long-term relationships with y'all. That's why they be ejaculating in y'all. That's why they be moving in with y'all and letting y'all move in with them. This is why they be giving y'all access to their bank account. This is why they be giving y'all the PIN number to their checking account. You see what I'm saying? This is why they do that, because they're not thinking that women are these devious, manipulative creatures. If men knew that, then they would be emotionally stoic and they would be all like me. And then there would be no room to manipulate nobody. Because, for example, the men like me, you can't manipulate us, because ain't nothing there for you to manipulate. Ain't no emotion there for you to play with. Like, I don't care, you know. And then I'm going to wrap it up with this. So, you know, it's like a lot of black, so-called pro-black females on YouTube who, it's like almost like their beauty got a lot of you niggas tricked. And I'm not saying that they ain't spitting some real shit. Some of them are, you know, I ain't gonna take that from them, but it's like, you guys are not, that's the emotional stoicism that I'm saying. You know, you get trapped by her disabling dust. Like when I talked about on the Black Up Male tape with the Poison Ivy thumbnail, the disabling dust, like a woman's beauty is, it disables you niggas. And it leaves you emotionally vulnerable. This is what I'm talking about. So that means that, and once again, ain't nothing wrong with a woman being fine and you being like, damn, she fine. And once again, black bear do that shit. I do that all the time. Of course, when I see a woman and she fine, I'ma hype that shit up. But I'm not gonna become emotionally vulnerable. Like, I'm not gonna be so awestruck that I'm not really paying attention to what she's saying, how she's really behaving. It's like I'm just in this daze, like how Poison Ivy had Batman and Robin with that little dust. It's like how I'm just hypnotized by her beauty to where she just bullshitting me right in my face and doing stuff and I can't even see it. And that's how you black up men have really been the last few hundred years. It's like these black women have like really deceived y'all. They've been Negro bed stenching in you niggas' faces. You know what I'm saying? They be doing all kind of shit, bro. And y'all niggas just can't fucking see it because you don't have no type of emotional stoicism and you are emotionally vulnerable. And they know it. They know it. You know, a lot of this stuff, man, I've talked about this shit with women. You know, I have. And if you look real close in my comment section, you will see a lot of women keeping it 100 about the shit that I'm saying. They will actually admit, like, you know, LOL, what you saying is true. You know, like, LOL, you know, dang, that's crazy. Like, they not going to lie to y'all. They will admit it. Like, when I be asking women, do they be really doing these things? And are these tactics really useful? And, like, they be telling me, yeah. That's the funny thing. Like, a lot of these, you know, a lot of these so-called black women, like, they really don't be lying to you once you get to really talking to them. Or at least they don't be lying to me. They be telling me how they be finessing you niggas. You know what I'm saying? They be telling me. Like, I had one tell me how she finessed this fucking white boy. I told y'all that story one time about the black female I knew who said that her friend, you know, heard about this white boy. And long story short, she just, because she heard that the white boy was always trying to go after black females. So she was like, oh, I got something for him. So basically she had finessed the white boy into eating her ass out. And she just never talked to him again. So she just wanted to finesse him out of that. But yeah, it's like, you know, these women be telling me this shit because they can tell that I'm emotionally stoic, you know, and I'm detached from certain things that they are attached to. So they know, okay, I can deal with this guy. He ain't gonna go head over heels for some shit like I will. Maybe he can goddamn keep a sane, stable mind. So in a time of conflict, at least there's one person on the scene that got their head together. So in other words, when a woman is with a man, the man has to be like the designated driver. And it's like the woman is the one who's drunk. You know what I'm saying? But the man, he can't be drinking. He got to be the one that's sober so he can drive the car home. And that's what I mean off of emotions. The woman is already drunk off of emotions. She's intoxicated off that shit. So the man can't be intoxicated too, because then who going to drive the car to get y'all home? So the man has to be emotionally stoic. He can't invest in his emotions like that. I'm not saying you got to cut yourself off and just be completely bitter and cold. That's not what I'm saying. But it's a certain portion of yourself that you're going to have to goddamn, you know, not let be vulnerable. And you're going to have a defense up, you know. But I just wanted to drop this this occult shit, man. You know, this is very, very important. You know, listening and taking the Tupac example. You know, women, once your face card is ruined, like once you smash the homies or some shit like that, man, that's just a wrap, man. And all the man going to do is emotionally detach from you. He going to act like he didn't really know you and don't really care no more. And that's why. Because he going to have to save his own self. What you think he going to have him looking like a fool? He already mad that he spent money on you and shit like that. So this is what we do as men, you know. But I hope this shit made sense. You know, it damn sure made sense to me because it just took my whole shit to another level. But I just want to drop this shit, man. It's the boy Blackbeard. I'm out.